Welcome. So today we're going to discuss elements of Chapter 5 for scope management. And scope management actually takes us in several different areas. So the first thing we're going to talk about is what we call project scope. Now, the project scope is everything salient that we need to know about the project. We need to know what work is to be done, what are the expected outcomes. We're also going to need to know who's responsible for what. And basically, also, we need to break out the work into manageable bites. It's the old adage, how do you eat an elephant? And it's one bite at a time. So we need to break down the work into what we'll call a work breakdown structure to be able to do that. So some additional things in scope management is we have to function in a way to where we can control a project. To make sure that it meets the goals and objectives and doesn't get out of control. So that's something that we're going to do here. We're going to talk a little bit more about control systems later, but at least here we're going to bring it up in the beginning. So there's six main activities that help us with scope management. One is we need a conceptual development to kind of give us an idea of what actually is going on. We need a scope statement, and that's going to pretty much outline what we were talking about above. A work authorization saying yes, it's okay to go ahead. Also scope reporting. Now, what does that mean? That kind of means where the scope may be drifting during the project, and we'll talk more about that later. So we want to make sure that we ensure that we don't have the scope drift too far off course. Otherwise, we're going to go over budget and over time and all those other things that go along with it. And then control systems that help us do that. And then, of course, project closeout at the end. So this kind of is hitting a lot of items that we're going to go into more detail later on in other chapters, but at least it's going to wrap our brains around the whole process. So first of all, let's talk about conceptual development. So by definition, conceptual development is the process that addresses project objectives by finding the best ways to meet them. And there are essential nine key elements. One is our problem or need statement. So we need to identify and really justify why this project, why are we doing it? And that's where the problem and need statement comes in. We also have to gather the requirements for this. You're not going to necessarily know all the requirements at the get-go. There oftentimes lots of research needs to be done or preliminary studies sometimes need to be done to figure out what are the requirements for this type of thing. And maybe even getting information from vendors and contractors to help nail that down. That kind of goes along with information gathering. That's a little bit more of the same thing, but it could be information other than requirements that you need, cost information, things like that. Any constraints we have? Well, obviously budget usually is a constraint, so but there may be other constraints. There may be legal constraints. There may be regulatory constraints. There could be all sorts of types of things. There's usually human resource constraints. Any alternative analyses? So this is going back to chapter three, where we looked at, okay, well, there could be several project ideas that could take care of this same problem, need, or statement. And so we pick two, three, four, whatever it is. And try to embellish those enough to where we make some type of analysis on those different approaches to the same thing. And the alternative analysis should then allow us to select which project should be the best fit for what those problems and needs are. We may have project objectives that we have to outline. We have to understand what do we want to accomplish by this. So the problem and need statement gives us focus as to where we're applying, but what do we actually want to achieve is what our project objectives are. We also have to justify our business case. You know, we're investing money and our time. Is this a for-profit business where they want to get a certain return off of that? Or is it a non-for-profit where you're basically trying to achieve the objectives, and it's an investment in that? So that could be like an environmental project, that could be an infrastructure project, all sorts of things like that. A lot of government projects fall into that category. The statement of work, or SOW, we're going to talk about that in more detail. It's very important because it identifies a need potentially within an organization, or it could be identifying the opportunity from an outside source. So it just depends upon the nature of the project. And finally, a project charter, which basically is a document we'll get into a little bit more that states, hey, we've analyzed this project, we've looked it over, we've looked at alternatives, and we're going to give our blessing by some sponsor or something, or some champion at the end saying, this is the way we're going to go. And they sign off of it. It's kind of like the official go ahead. So let's look at the statement of work, which is an important component. And kind of what is it? Well, it's a detailed narrative description. That's kind of the fundamental there. And it's a description of the work that's going to be required to complete our project. So what should be included and what should not be included kind of dictates what we call an effective SOW. So there are several things. One thing, it has to have an introduction and background. This really helps define that pain or that need. It also helps us kind of figure out what our objectives might be. Technical description of the project. You know, what exactly are we going to do? What kind of technical issues are we going to have? Is this a construction project? Is this a build-out project? You know, what capabilities do we foresee needing? And also the timeline and milestones. That's kind of a key. How long do we think it's going to take? These will probably be edited over and over again because you may have your initial estimates, but not until you actually do a whole scheduling and resource map. And that could be in several different forms, like a Gantt chart, a PERT chart. We'll get to those later. Will you actually even know, is my timeline even appropriate? So, and what are those milestones? So, you know, that's all things that need to be worked out in the fullness of time. So what is the purpose of a statement of work? Well, it's there to identify an internal need or an external opportunity, like we said before. It does create the narrative description of the work to be required to develop a particular solution. So that's how it ties into those objectives. Those objectives are part of the solution of a need or problem or pain statement. It does have several key components. And if you note, as we go through these components, we're actually moving from general components to very specific, starting with the background. Background, again, this is going to describe the project in general terms, pretty much, while we're pursuing the relationship to possibly other projects. Maybe we have other projects that are complementary to what we're doing here. That's very common in large organizations like NIH, where they may be doing research across one area, and they have a theme of their research, and so they have different components to that. That's just one example. Included sometimes whose authority do we have for us to do it, and what are some of the regulations, materials, anything that supports our background, any references, research that supports this idea. Then we move on to objectives, getting a little more specific. So here we want to have a concise overview of the results and the deliverables that we want. And what will they be used for? That leads us down to the scope and saying, okay, now we've identified these needs and these objectives. Let's really limit and put a box around a certain piece of work so that we can limit ourselves to what we can control in this in a scope. That's really what we're trying to do is nail down what exactly are we doing and what, probably more importantly, what are we not doing so that we make sure we don't drift off course. So this is the scope is just the general scope of work for a particular project team or contractor or whatever they are and what they'll be performing. We then move down to tasks or requirements. This is a more detailed discussion of the work to be done. And so we're basically going from the scope, which is the larger level, down to requirements, which is one level down. So we're kind of starting to break out the work into pieces and what are the management requirements there. And we have to define what's expected from each project team or the contractor itself. Then we move on to number five, selection criteria. This is now where we're going to create or identify object standards of some form of performance by our project team. So we want to make sure that we can put a line in the sand, say, okay, X, Y, and Z needs to happen at minimum. If we do better and we perform better, great. But here's what we need at minimum. And you could put a minimum, a medium, or some mid-level, which is oftentimes where you end up, and a high. You can have those type of performance levels. Deliverables or delivery schedule. Now we're actually defining at the endpoint what will we provide in each component. Deliverable may have a whole bunch of subcomponents under it to help provide whatever that deliverable is. There's going to be specific responsibilities by different groups to come up with that deliverable. There's also going to be a timeline associated with that deliverable, and usually a cost associated with that deliverable. And these deliverables could be devices, it could be documentation, specific services, training, maybe quantities of things, widgets, who knows? It just depends upon the project. And then some things that we may have to be concerned about is like security. So there may be security requirements that we have to be concerned with. For example, if we're working in healthcare IT, anything to do with information in healthcare, well, we have to comply with HIPAA requirements that require certain data security. And that's just one example. If we're doing something for a DoD, it might require much higher levels of security and even background checks on everybody who works on the project. And maybe you have to have certain clearance. So those types of things can be a consideration. There's also, where are we going to do the work? Place of performance, meaning essentially, where are we going to do the work? Are we going to do it on a contractor site, on a government site? Are we doing it on site for the company? You know, where is this work being done? Sometimes that needs to be specified. And for how long? Period of performance is really how long do we have to complete the project? So that kind of outlines all the components of a statement of work, those nine things. So you're going to want to remember that. Let's say we get all that done and we get it approved, then there's a document that usually gets drafted called a project charter. This is most common in consulting work, or many large organizations will establish one of these after the statement of work is done. So it's essentially exactly what we say, a document. It's going to be issued by the project initiator or sponsor, usually somebody in high-level management or authority, who can formally sanction this project and that they want it to move forward. So it's basically you're authorized to go and start, because now then you're going to be applying financial resources, human resources, and all sorts of things to this project. It is usually created once project sponsors have done their homework and verify that A, there's a business case, particularly for for-profit, B, there's elements of the project are understood, and C, company-specific information for the project has already been applied. And it also demonstrates a formal company approval for the project. Now, if you are working as a contractor or a consultant for another group, this usually is a legal document to say, okay, we've agreed to the work that we're going to do, and now this is where we can start invoicing for billables and start work. So it's kind of a delineation in the sand of the start button, so to speak. So scope statement. What is a scope statement? Well, it's essentially documentation to define and approve most important project parameters during the planning process. Easy for me to say. It does have several components. Number one is we need to get our goal criteria, and we need to establish those. There's five criteria in general. Cost is always one. Schedule is always one. Performance, how well do we meet those goals? So this is something that you guys have been looking at already in our first plan. And then deliverables, that's kind of a key one because that's how we're going to break out our work. And then E is review and approval gates with stakeholders. The second one is having a management plan, and we're going to need to develop that. And the third one is going to be establish a work breakdown structure. We're going to go into that in much more detail. It's where we can break down our work into tasks or subtasks. Now, the They have other names for them depending upon which group you talk about. We'll go into that more. And we have to create what we call a scope baseline. Now, a scope baseline is our initial scope is when we start the plan, we say, we're going to do X, Y, Z. And that's it. We're not doing anything more. We're not doing anything less. So that it's well-defined and understood, the work limits, so to speak. It's like the boundaries of the work, so we don't go overboard. Now, ideally, it'd be great if that scope stayed the same all the time. However, it usually does not, unfortunately. Could be for several reasons why it may drift. Could be customers, all sorts of things, who want more all of a sudden because they didn't realize that they wanted more. But you have to plan for those things where the scope could drift, and you want to make sure that it doesn't drift too far off, particularly if you're on a fixed budget. So we'll talk more about that once we get near to the end of the lecture. But for now, let's talk more on the work breakdown structure, or WBS. It is a deliverable-oriented grouping of project tasks or steps. It organizes and defines the total scope of the project. And again, we're breaking it down into the smallest units. Each descending level represents increasingly detailed definition of a project task. So that's it in a nutshell. That really still doesn't tell us what the heck we're doing here. So it serves six main purposes. These are essentially coming out of the book. I mean, so we want to make sure that the work breakdown structure enables us to get to those project objectives. It gives us a little bit of organization chart for the project. Not necessarily, it does break out the deliverables, and sometimes people wrap groups around each deliverable. Just depends upon how you organize that. Creates logic for tracking costs, schedule, and performance. It does communicate project status. That's something, for instance, Microsoft Project does very, very well because it aligns those tasks, and then you can have a Gantt chart next to it, and you can literally track on that chart where you're at, so which is kind of nice. Improves project communication, demonstrates control structure. Now, the work breakdown structure has to be broken down into individual work packages. Now, that's another word that they use. I was taught task. Some people call it work package. Doesn't really matter what you call it as long as you're consistent. What it represents is the lowest level in a work breakdown structure, and it has the following characteristics. It is the most basic step or task. It basically makes it as one deliverable result assigned to one owner. So it's something that one person can manage. So that's how we break it down, because if we have one person who can manage it, then we can assign that person to be the owner and have accountability to that piece. Makes a lot of sense. So, but really, each piece has a start, middle, and end. So it's really a micro project, if you will. And so one big project is a whole series of micro projects just orchestrated and organized. It may or may not have milestones. It could be small enough that just getting it done is a milestone. Or maybe it requires a little more, and you might have milestones to getting that piece done. That is possible. It must fit the organization. It must also fit the organizational procedures and structure. And it needs to be trackable. And trackable usually means trackable on schedule. Where are we at on schedule? And also trackable in cost. Those are the two biggies. We could track on human resources as well. Or other resources. So a simple example, and this gets used a lot. On one of the examples I posted in the course, this is kind of the form that they use. So this is a diagram that breaks it down into kind of a hierarchy. Now this is what they're talking about by a structural hierarchy, because essentially we could say, here's the whole project 1.0. Here's deliverable. Now, it's interesting, they didn't do 1.1. Here's deliverable, let's say 2, deliverable 3, 4, and 5. So these are distinct deliverables that we identified. Well, what's it going to take to get deliverable 2? Well, we needed to break it down into three sub-steps. So 1.2.1, 1.2.2, 1.2.3, and each of these, one owner and one person can be in control of and make sure that they do these. Now, what this does do, it gives us kind of a organizational structure view of things. What it does not do is it does not really allow us to look at things on a timeline very well, which is a different viewpoint. So some people like to look at that better, but it is one form to do it. So, and a couple things to keep in mind is that at this level, these are major project components that designate the deliverables. This is the whole project always at the top. So this is the final project as the deliverable, but all the components, all the deliverables that that project needs to have are at this hierarchical level. Once you break it down further, and usually it's broken down to this level, sometimes there's even these tasks that need to be broken down even further, which is fine. It just depends upon how complex the project is. So these work packages, again, it's work package or task, whatever you want to call it, are individual project activities. And so these are the lowest levels where we can really designate who's responsible. So that is one form, and that's more of a structural form. If we look at a different form, this is a form that you can do in Microsoft Project. This is actually a screen out of Microsoft Project 13, and it organizes it a little bit different. Now, Microsoft Project calls it tasks. That's why I'm used to calling it tasks instead of the other mode. So the task names each are on these lines. And so if you notice there's lines, it's almost like an Excel matrix. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so there's always a number that's going to be associated with each name. And usually in the name, it is good practice to put a numbering system. So the overall project here is IT installation. One of the deliverables for this is 1.1, which is match IT to org tasks, organization tasks. The second deliverable is identify IT user needs. Another deliverable is prepare informal proposal, and so on. The subtasks then are these. And you can actually, if you notice, it's almost like they're tabbed. It's just like indentations on paragraphs. So here's conduct problem analysis, identify info on IT technology, blah, blah, blah. So this task here and this task here would have individuals who would be responsible for each of these pieces. And next to that in the screen is a calendar. And this is where usually we will see later on, once we do scheduling, schedules for timelines will actually show up on here. And there's different ways we can do task modes. We can do them manually, which is kind of this little insignia here, meaning we can say where they go on the schedule, or we can do them automatically. And automatically is kind of nice because it ties one task to other tasks, so that if you know that they have to be done in series. That's when we get down to scheduling, so I'm getting a little ahead of myself. We can also say which ones are precedence of others, meaning one thing has to occur before another thing. So again, it's just a different way of looking at the same thing. So the deliverables, i.e. the top level, are on these categories, these major categories. And then the tasks end up being, or subtasks end up being down here. All right, let's look at the organizational breakdown structure, OBS. What is it and what does it allow us to do? Well, it allows entities to define work, assign work packages or tasks. I put tasks on everything because work packages is just so burdensome to me for me to say to owners. It assigns budgets to departments for activities. And essentially, by doing those things, it gives us something that's fundamental. It links cost, activity, and responsibility together. So it answers the question, who's doing it? What is the cost for that activity? And by the way, it links it to that work breakdown structure. So you kind of have to have the work breakdown structure done first before you can do the organizational breakdown structure. Here's one example that they show in the book. So here's a work breakdown structure, again, except this one's a 1.3, 1.4, 1.5. And maybe these are simple things, so they can just be done by themselves. But this one, 1.4, needed to be broken out into three different components because it was a little more complex. And not only that, it's going to take more than one department. So structurally, it's going to take different groups in a company or an organization to be able to do this. So for example, 1.4.1 is a search committee. Well, the search committee, because the overall goal is to seek and hire an IT consultant. Okay, well, how are they going to do that? Well, they have established a search committee. Who is that going to be on that committee? Well, they need somebody from their own information systems as a representative who knows what the needs are. They're also going to need somebody from human resources. And in this case, they're not going to need anybody from procurement in that stage. But there's going to be a cost and accounting associated with each of these departments contributing to get this piece done. The next piece, development criteria, is going to require somebody or some time, some resource from all three of these departments. And in the end, the selection of the consultant is just going to come down to the information systems group. So if you note, these are the relationships here. So the search committee has these, development criteria has these, this one has that. So they just kind of map it like that. So that helps for certain things when you need to understand what that is. It doesn't have to be in this format, but it's a way to do it. So what does it look like when we fleshed it out a little bit? Well, does it really cost? Is there any cost associated with that? And they put zeros here for search committee. You could argue that that's not realistic because there's still time involved. You know, when you're using somebody's time, some percentage of their time to be on the search committee, well, that's money. But they're talking about any additional cost. And there really should be if there was a search committee, because you usually have to put out, you know, a request for proposal or something like that. Here in the development criteria, they did put $500 for each department, which totals to $1,500. And then over here, just $1,000 on this department. So there's a couple ways we can look at this. So we have matches our department costs with an associated task or activities for budgeting purposes. So this is going to allow us to start figuring out what's going to be the cost for each of these tasks. And so each task, so for example, I asked a couple questions here. So what is, looks like what is, but information systems overall cost for executing deliverable 1.4? Well, 1.4 is up here. So what's the overall cost for executing this deliverable? Well, it's not going to be any of these columns because actually we have to sum up all these totals. So you'd actually have to sum this row right here. So it'd be 0 plus 1500 plus 1000. So it actually is $2,500 is what we're assuming it's going to cost to do 1.4. So which task, I hate using work package, what task requires the most overall capital within 1.4? Well, that becomes pretty obvious when you see it in this manner. It's actually this one, $1,500 for 1.4.2. So it's just an easy way to figure all that out and map it out. So that's one aspect of mapping cost and activity and responsibility. The other type of thing is we may need to know more about responsibility. So there's something called a responsibility assignment matrix, or RAM. And it does different things because you may have somebody who is responsible for completing the task, which one is these little open O's. So here, Bob in IT is responsible for developing a presentation, also responsible for a problem analysis. David's responsible for this, Susan's responsible for this, and so on. You can see where different people are responsible for what. I like these names: Susan HR, Beth Procurement, James Engineering, Terry Legal. So that kind of gives you their department and just a basic name for them. So who can be called on to support the task? So maybe somebody's spearheading the task, but they're going to need help. So in this case, Bob's responsible for the presentation, but David's going to help him. So he's going to be in support for that. They also need to notify and keep engineering up to date what's going on. But that's all they're doing with engineering, are these guys too. It could be notifying of task status, which is oftentimes what's going on, and or completion. So they usually need to be in the communications loop. And that could be via emails, which is a very easy way to do it as things go, or status meetings. And who approves and sign off the completion of the task? That's going to be these squares. So that could be Bob and IT signs off on this one, signs off on that one. Actually, he's the only one. Oh, and Terry Legal is one other one over here for problem analysis. So if you notice, not all these tasks require an approval, and probably they shouldn't. That would be micromanaging the whole process, but maybe some do. So keep that in mind. So let's talk about work authorization. This is really a formal go-ahead. Let's start working. So that could be on all sorts of pieces. So oftentimes we need to have contractual documentation. It possesses some key identifiable features. You need to have contractual requirements. And a work authorization is a little bit similar to the document that we mentioned earlier that really says this is where we can start. This is usually, a work authorization is usually reserved for contractors. When you're going to hire somebody to do a piece of work for you, you're giving them the external go-ahead, where the other one's usually an internal document. So here we have some things. We have to have contractual requirements. So sometimes that requires attorneys, oftentimes if it's a larger project. There has to have a valid consideration and contracted terms. So contractual requirement should consist of specific requirements agreed upon by all parties. And they need to be agreed upon before any work is done. This should prevent disagreements. Particularly, it should prevent lawsuits at the end if there's a disagreement on what was supposed to be done and what was done. There's also a valid consideration, items and commitments voluntarily agreed to by all parties, such as party one will provide funding and knowledge expertise toward the project, and party will provide manufacturing, testing, and fulfillment of products. So you want to be able to ensure that those things are agreed to as well, because maybe they're not monetary value, but sometimes you can't get a project done unless the other party is willing to give you certain knowledge expertise, and they have to agree to that, because if they say, hey, we're going to do this project, but no, I'm not going to let you know anything on our end about what we know about it, well, then you're not going to get very far. Sometimes it's testing or all sorts of things, depends upon the contract. And also the terms. There may be terms. There may be excusable delays, you know, weather, catastrophes. Katrina would have probably been an excusable delay. There's not much people could do about that, so they wouldn't be legally bound. Death of a key member sometimes. There's also allowable costs. Okay, we'll give you some flex within a certain percentage or a certain amount per period or what have you, because you don't know exactly. Statements of liquid damages in case of non-performance. This is very common in construction, less common in things that aren't well defined because by their nature, they're not well defined and it's difficult to know that ahead of time. But for construction, they oftentimes, that's been done so many times that people can usually nail down the cost pretty well. And so for example, I have a brother who's in commercial construction, and one of the things that they have anytime they're building something for a grocery store or some larger entity who wants to have a building done or refurbished is for each day that they're past the schedule, they may be backcharged so much. So it's actually eating into their profits if they don't get it done on time. So, and depending on the project, I mean, it could be $1,000 a day, it could be $10,000 a day. So that's major incentive to get the work done, get it done on time, and make sure it's good. So that could really hurt the contractor if they don't follow through with that. Okay. And contracts can range from one of two ends of the spectrum. Could be a lump sum, or what we call turnkey, or it could be what we call a cost plus type of contract. And these are two very different things. I have worked in both these situations. Cost plus contracts are good for the contractor because it allows you to say, okay, we're going to basically charge you cost, plus we get to charge a 7% profitability on top of that, just so that we have some profits after our costs. Okay, that's great as the contractor, because then there's really nothing holding you back for taking as long as it takes, and you keep charging them until you're done. But for the client, that's not necessarily what they want, because now all of a sudden a project can go way over. And you've seen that sometimes in government projects and things where it's not well defined and they do a cost plus. Oracle did that. There's a big example of that in Oregon when they were trying to roll out the Affordable Health Care Act. Well, Oregon decided they were going to do their own rollout plan and not use the government's plan. And even though the government's plan was bad, Oregon's was worse because they didn't do good project management. They had a full cost plus system, and Oracle was the one who was supposed to build it. Well, they were failing miserably. First of all, they didn't identify everybody quick enough on who the contractors were, and they didn't really hold them down to any major plan. And because it was cost plus, they just kept charging and charging and charging, and they pretty much spent all their money in a little over half the time, and the whole system didn't even work. And of course, the people who were supposed to be in charge of it were hiding the fact. They were just saying, oh yeah, it's going to be ready, da 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 da. But it was a train wreck underneath. So Oregon eventually had to go to the federal government system, because their system, all that money and cost that they spent was for naught. And so they had to scrap that and use the federal government's system anyway. Now, that's all the way on that end. On the other end, if it's a turnkey system, that's actually good for the client. It's really tough on the contractor. So if it's something that's well known, sometimes you can do that, like as in certain construction projects. But if it's not well known, which sometimes falls under engineering and science and technical projects, then that could be really harmful. We were on one of those. We were doing a project for Northrop Grumman, and we were building a robotic measurement system for naval nuclear launch tubes. And so we had to design, build, refurbish some stuff, make new systems. It was a whole wireless master-slave control robotic measurement system. So it was serious, but they had a budget and they wanted it to be $300,000. Well, because we were an upstart, you know, we were kind of starting up our offices out in Silicon Valley. We said, hey, we want to get that business, so we have it on our resume. Well, famous last words. Our founder was all excited about it because we could say, hey, we've got Northrop Grumman on there. But in the long run, it ended up costing us three times more than that, almost $900,000, almost $1 million to get that project done, because it was way underfunded. And we got totally hosed on that project. And we were working so many late nights and things like that, just trying to get it done. And it was just because it was much bigger than we estimated it was supposed to be. And also customer drift. There was a lot of that on there too. So that's something I know very painfully. Okay. Scope reporting. For this, it's essentially, when we're doing scope reporting, it's status reports. They have a whole bunch of fancy wordage in the book, but really we're talking about what's the status of each task, where we're at. What does it do? Well, it determines what types of information is reported. So we're kind of specifying that ahead of time. Also, who gets copies of that information, when do they get them, how the information is acquired and disseminated. So it's really setting up our communications and establishing what our procedures for communications are going to be for each piece. Typical project report should contain our cost status, where we are as far as what do we budget versus how much we've spent, where we are on schedule. Maybe we had a month to do the piece of the project and we're 2 weeks into it And are we actually halfway done, or are we only a quarter of the way done and we're 2 weeks into it? So that's important to know the difference. And then technical performance status. Are we getting the performance that we want, technically speaking? So that's a little bit different. So these are important because what we're trying to prevent is something called death marches. They have this kind of as a little project profile thing in the book, but I think it was worth talking about because it actually tells us something to learn from, something not to do. And so it's pretty startling when you look at why projects fail. How can we prevent that? That's kind of the whole point, learn from those mistakes. So the first thing that they mentioned before you've even gotten into the project are these. The entity, the business, government, whatever it is, starts you off and sets you up for failure before you even begin. And that is a huge problem. It is a huge problem in corporate America. And they sit there and promote productivity and all these types of things, where basically you're getting more work out of a person. Well, that's not always a good thing because sometimes you can't get any more. There's a limit. And they don't like to believe that all the time. Anyway, that's getting more of a philosophical discussion. But it has become a big problem because you're having more and more, a lot of projects that are failing because they're not allocating resources. And there's mistrust between management and those that are giving them all these estimates. So what happens is then upper management starts the projects off with 40 to 60% less time or 40 to 60% less amount of human resources or 40 to 60% less money or budget to actually get the project done, rather than going with the estimates that the specialists, the people who do have the knowledge, suggested that they actually needed. So say, for example, you say, you know, we have a project. We want to build this new product. It's going to be great, but it's going to cost us $1 million, let's say. It's going to require 20 people, and it's going to require us 6 months to get this thing launched, or a year, whatever it is. And upper management comes back and says, great, let's do the project, but sorry, we don't want to spend that much money. We're going to give you $500,000, and we're only going to give you 10 people, and we want it done in 3 months instead of 6 months. Well, that's awful, because what they've done is, one, they've proven the point as upper management that they don't believe in the expertise of their people, and they don't trust them. That's horrible, because for morale, that kills it immediately. And upper-level management and corporations have got to stop doing that. They're being ridiculous, and they're doing it on the guise of pressure of shareholders, which is the absolute wrong reason to be doing it. Our corporate structure has to change. Otherwise, we're not going to be able to do anything effectively anymore, because you're basically pandering to the groups that all they want is to get money out of the system rather than actually provide anything of value. Because if you do this, none of your projects that you're underfunding and undercutting in the beginning are going to work out, or you're going to get really limited results off of this. Now, they go into a lot of things in the book, but there's nine components of this. There's politics, naive promises, naive optimism of youth, and that oftentimes is more in a startup world where you can see some of that. Startup mentality of fledgling entrepreneurial companies, you see that. Marine Corps mentality, you need to do this and we're going to do more with less. I can't tell you how many times we heard that, and really what they got, less with less. So there are limits to that. There are ways you can improve efficiencies on things such as automation of repeat items and things like that. But that's sensible. That's different than this, what we're talking about here. Intense competition caused by globalization. Yeah, I think we overplay that a bit, but we can still compete in a lot of different things. Intense competition caused by appearance of new technologies. You know, that's also this sense that you have to consume, consume, consume. That could be changed by consumer behavior. What's a good example of that? Well, Apple wants you to buy a new cell phone every 2 years. Why? Because they want to grow their margins. They want to grow their profits and become even a bigger company, even though they're already one of the biggest companies in the world. Does that make sense on the consumer side? Probably not. There's no reason why you need to buy a new one every 2 years, particularly at the prices that they want you to pay. So they're actually trying to undercut. I was just reading the Wall Street Journal. They're trying to undercut all the providers like Verizon and AT&T and T-Mobile and Sprint and the others. Cut them out of the deal entirely to where you're financing your phone directly through Apple. And so you're going to just start paying them constantly so that you can always upgrade your phone and cutting out that other provider. Think about that. Think about that. When they start trying to change your behavior for their benefit, think about if it's actually as a consumer, is that in your best interest? So don't always fall for the shiny. I guess that's my whole point there. Okay. Intense pressure caused by unexpected government regulations. That is a pressure, and sometimes that happens. Congress can be fickle, either at state government or federal government, and then they change the rules, and now you've got to do some costly changes. That can happen. And some of them are for good, some of them are not. So that's a whole nother discussion we don't have time for at this point. Unexpected or unplanned crises, that can happen too. Like I said, any catastrophes and stuff like that can kill a project. So, okay. So there are the things that we can't control, but out of the things that we can control, we do have some lever arms or some control systems to help us keep projects on time. And there's about six that they kind of like to identify. And there's different ways we can do each one of these. So number one is a configuration control. The whole point of the configuration control is to monitor emerging or creeping scope, meaning that maybe the customer is asking for more deliverables. And say, you know what, I like that interface on the website, but it'd be really great if we could add this or that or three other little things. That shouldn't be hard, right? Well, they usually do not have an appreciation for the amount of work and time it can be invested into creating that one little change or those three little changes. I've been on that end and I've seen what that does. And so that's where you do time and materials and say, well, you do that, it's going to take X amount of time and X amount of more onto the project. You'd be surprised how fast that they decide, well, maybe it's not that important. another one is design control. Monitor scope and cost and scheduling during the design phase. So this is kind of interesting. This is a pre-control, really, if you think about it. It's in the design phase of a widget or a product that you're making. And so what they do is you go through the design process. And now it goes under review under some experienced folks who are in that process. So this usually is something that can be done in organizations that have done design a lot. Car companies, plane companies, manufacturer contractors. And they can look at the design and say, you know what? This is not this design, the way you've done it here, isn't going to fall under the cost constraints we have or the scheduling. This is going to take us longer because this requires two machines or three machines doing different things that we can't do. But if we made a little adjustment to the design, we could cut that cost and time to build that widget just by making a design change. Huge cost savings if they can do that. And that's actually under an engineering group who would be doing something like that. But again, they have to have some embedded experience. That's not something that usually startups or newbies usually have at their disposal because oftentimes it's a brand new process that they're trying. Trend monitoring. This is to track costs, schedule, and resources needed, the actual need versus what the plan is. So if they start seeing that, you know what, it's actually taking us longer to do this than we anticipated, or actually we need another person or two people because we're not getting it done on schedule, and that's going to cost more. That's a drift. That's a drift in our scope. So there's going to be a delta there between that and what we planned on spending. So we need to track that. And so if we have a delta that goes in one direction, aka more, cost, more resources, longer schedule, then somewhere else we may need to find a way to decrease that delta, or already have in the plan a buffer, which we'll talk about later, so that when these things happen, it's not if, but when these things happen, we've already accounted for that conservatively in our original estimation. Document control has to be done, particularly for anything that you're going to do in government. Healthcare, big one, because you have to track your documentation for any widget that you make. FDA requires that. So tracks, organizes, and executes proper documentation. So you usually need to have documents at each step of the way. And different people may need to sign off on it. And you may need to know what documents you need to have. And it goes on and on. Acquisition control monitors time and need of equipment, material, and service acquisition. So you may need to have certain equipment in place and the facilities up and running before you actually need that piece of equipment for maybe manufacturing. You have to actually develop a whole manufacturing line before you can build a certain chip. And that line has to be ready and ready to roll in a timely fashion right before that chip's going to be built and everything has to be tooled and ready to go. So that's an example of something like that. So those are things that have to be timed and also have to be considered. So specification control, tracks, prepares, communicates specifications to all necessary parties. Specifications may change. You may have certain specs for a helicopter and suddenly those specs need to change for whatever reason because maybe the materials aren't available or maybe what we thought we could do isn't physically possible because we don't have materials that can do what we wanted to do. All those kinds of things. A little bit more on configuration management. It's kind of defined as a system of procedures that monitors emerging project scope against a baseline. Now that requires then documentation approval of any changes to a baseline. Well, we said baseline twice, so we better figure out what baseline actually means. So that's actually defined as the project scope fixed at a specific point in time. Now, the baseline is always established at the project schedule's start date. So the baseline means we've estimated, say, 1 year of time for our project. It's going to cost $10 million, and it's going to require 30 people. Any drift from that is a drift from baseline. So if we need to change our scope, say, you know what, it's actually going to cost another $200,000 that we didn't foresee, or we actually don't need all these people. Usually you don't do it in the backward sense, only if you have to usually increase on scope. Or maybe we didn't realize that we needed to have this safety feature because our batteries are overheating. So we need to add a component that we did not foresee. Those have to be approved by management. Sometimes it's an engineering change. Sometimes it's upper level management that needs to authorize that change. But there could be all sorts of reasons why you need to monitor that. And you're always checking against where do we start with that baseline. Once your baseline has been moved by approvals through management, now you have a new baseline. And that could be at time, whatever, wherever you're at. And so that's your new baseline. So it's really something as a level of comparison constantly that you can go at. Okay, we could have project changes. They can occur for several reasons. So we could have planning errors at the get-go, very common. You usually can't think of everything. They could be human errors, technological errors, you know, what have you. Maybe we learned something while we're going through the project. And so learning, we have more knowledge and there's things that we find out that we couldn't think of. Could be environmental conditions, could be all sorts of things. Uncontrollable mandates. There could be a mandate from the government to require something. Or the client requests more items or more features. That always can do changes. Now, it's interesting because in software, project management used to be run in the old-fashioned way, when client requests would come in, it would really throw it for a loop. But they're actually becoming more adaptable types of models on how do you do project management like that, where you change requests on the fly, and you actually implement a constant way to do that. And so they actually put that in early on, even in the statement of work, so that they are accounting for that at the get-go rather than having it be a surprise later, because it happens so often. And then finally, the project closeout. The job is done, or so we thought. It's not done or over until the paperwork is done, which is different than the end of an opera. So closeout documentation is used to do the following things. We don't want to have any disputes, so we want to have those resolved. So the paperwork resolves that. Maybe we need to train the project managers on what happened, what went well, what didn't, and facilitate auditing. This is very important if you want to learn from the project. What went right? What went wrong? What could we have done better? All those types of things. It also is important for the closeout between the client and the contractor, if it's for something external, making sure that everybody did what they were supposed to do and upheld their end on deliverables and what they agreed to do. So here's closeout documentation includes historical records, any post-project analysis, financial closeouts, technical documents. Those could be all sorts of things. So when, say, we did a project for 3Com one time where we built a whole testing system for them, an automated testing system. We took one of their, it used to be the Ethernet cards, which we use for internet or, back in the day. They were going from the 10 base T systems to 100 base T systems at the time. And we built an automated system. They initially were testing these systems, and it was taking a technician about 2 weeks to test one board. Well, we helped them build an automated system, and we took that 2 weeks down to 2 minutes to test a board in an automated fashion. So that's called an efficiency, and that's where productivity makes sense, when you can automate something. That's different. But of course, they needed to know how to use it, and we had to write operation manuals for the software. I had to do training for the people who are going to use it so they understood it. And so we had to have training docs. Some things, devices will have to have maintenance manuals. That's very common in healthcare. Every device has to have a maintenance manual. The same with your cars, you have maintenance manuals. They could have just basic operation manuals too. So oftentimes these are also deliverable documents for things that you need to have. So this is kind of the summary. I want to make sure that you understand the importance of the scope management, the significance of a scope statement. You guys will be working on already a work breakdown structure. So this kind of discusses that. Also, you want to be able to know how to develop a responsibility assignment matrix and describe the roles and of changes in configuration management in assessing a project scope and trying to prevent drift. Okay, so that's the end of our show today. I will see you next time, and I look forward to it. So take care.